Welcome to The Breakdown, where we break down all the messed up movies. Last Monday, you all voted for Gerald's Game. And so, what, do you think I'm stupid? Script kitty? 4,000 people did not vote. Someone just botted in votes so that Therese would win, even though it was at the bottom. I was watching the poll, pal. The funny thing is that Gerald's Game still won. We will get to them all, don't trip. Gerald's Game is the film adaption of the Stephen King novel, long thought to be best read. Jessie and her husband Gerald are ready for a romantic weekend secluded away. Truth is that these two have not done anything together in months, so some handcuffs might spice things up. It would be a shame if something were to happen to Gerald, leaving Jessie locked up to the bed. Would it be a shame though? Maybe this is just what Jessie needs to confront the pains of her life. This movie is easily on Netflix, so if you want to watch it yourself, go right ahead. If you want to see what happens, including all the messed up parts, stay tuned for the breakdown. Cue the Gohan. Bring it on home. That is the song playing in the beginning. A lady is packing her bags along with her husband. Handcuffs going in too. If police don't have them, then they must be for knocking boots. They drive through a beautiful forest. It reminds me of the drive the family did at the beginning of Funny Games. She's a pretty lady too. Her name is Jessie. Maybe she had a few spy kids in a previous marriage. She doesn't like that song playing, Bring It On Home. You can sense a little baggage she is constantly carrying. Gerald, watch out for the dog! He must really be thinking about playing that game of his. This dog is starving, eating an opossum. That dog looked like he's visiting Earth. Anyway, the couple reached the cabin. She goes walking around and looks at the beautiful scenery. Man, as you get older, you can't beat that. Dang, refrigerator pre-stocked? Plus it's got some fine Kobe ribeye in it. She gives some to the stray dog, but he's not around right now. Gerald takes his first Viagra for the day meanwhile. Oh, never mind, the dog is here. Walking up kind of scary. Gerald scares the mutt away. It's time for some fine loving. They rush inside for sex, but they leave the door wide open. She gets into her new gown and takes the tag off on the shelf above the bed. She wasn't expecting real handcuffs and is then attached to both bed frames. This is the first time they are doing something like this, by the way. She also wasn't expecting Gerald to start a rape fantasy roleplay. It's a little tough for her to get into the roleplay, and she has to fight him off. See, y'all should have organized a safe word first. Either way, she doesn't like this at all. They get into an argument. This visit was to try new stuff out, make things more exciting, after he doesn't even like touch her for months. When they finally do something, turns out he has some weird rape fantasy. Seems it's pretty common though, but you gotta communicate. She asks him to unlock the cuffs, but he keeps going. She's gotta kick him away at some points. We were happy once, he says. But right before he keeps talking, he's in huge pain. He can't even do anything but fall out. Gerald's having a heart attack. Gerald dies, leaving her locked to the bed with no escape. A sex nightmare from hell. Gerald is dead, ma'am. Dead. You better do what George Costanza did, because it looks like you'll be next in line. Jessie is hoping it's a joke, but it's really not. He's already at the pearly gates by now. He hit his head on the way down, confirming he's dead for real. She's like, oh shit, at this point. Hours start to pass. Gerald is dead on the floor, but she hears something creeping outside. You can recall that they left the door wide open, so whatever it is, it feels invited. Pitter-patter, pitter-patter. It's that stray dog from earlier, looking for seconds of that meat. Jessie is pretty sarcastic in this situation. Peter Parker level quips while locked up. That stray dog is so hungry that it literally bites chunks out of Gerald's arm before running away. It boldly eats the chunks of Gerald right in front of her. But then, this dude Gerald gets up! Wait, Gerald was alive all along? He's responding to the bite, but he should be in a lot more pain. But then, suddenly, he starts blaming her for the dog coming in. This is beating yourself up one-on-one. Nobody criticizes themselves better than themselves. When you have as much baggage as Jessie, it becomes a huge issue. Jessie is viewing hallucinations of Gerald. So yes, Gerald is dead, but this Gerald, who continuously talks to her, often in a degrading way, is called Inner Gerald. It's almost like a mean therapy session, using him to beat herself up and also realizes things about Gerald that she often ignored. Like, for example, maybe Gerald only thought women were good for one thing. That's putting it in a PBS Kids way. He also taunts her situation to make her feel hopeless. Or did he? Suddenly, she squeezes her hands out of the cuffs, getting right to that bed frame and getting free her other arm. Wow, that was easy. Not. Jessie just hallucinated herself breaking free. This is inner Jessie that broke free. Now both inner hallucinations are arguing with each other. It becomes more than just escaping from a sex misadventure. Jessie is going to be doing a lot of confronting today, as life is on the line for her too. She's got about 3 days at best. Talking with inner Gerald buys the time as they go through the ups and downs of their sex life. Who exactly did I marry? Was the question made when she first realized he could only get it up when he chokes her and stuff like that. Wait, that's not the only way he got hard. He also used those blue pills. With a sip of water, she realizes that he left a glass of water on the shelf above the bed and carefully gets it off. Sucks that she can't take a drink. So inner Jessie tells her to put it back up. Wait, the dog. Dang, that dog is hungry again. Then inner Gerald helps her realize that she put the tag of her gown on the bed shelf too. She grabs it, hoping to use it as a straw to get a drink. Very good thinking. Looks like he's good for something. Jessie leaves some for later, and the inner couple guide her to sleep for the next day of survival. As she sleeps, something is creeping through the house. Whatever it is, the dog is scared out of the building. Jessie wakes up seeing that dog is replaced by a tall, creepy figure. Who is this scary man and his chest full of bones and booty? Inner Gerald tells her that maybe he isn't real, maybe he is. But that is the Moonlight Man, the representation of Jessie's approaching death. Inner Gerald calls her Mouse at one point though. Why Mouse? She then slips to sleep. See, when Jessie was just a wee lad, her father called her Mouse. At one point in her childhood, her family went out to a trip to a lake house. Instantly, we can see that Jessie's father sees her different than he sees his other kids. The entire family goes on a boat, leaving Dad and young Jessie together for eclipse viewing. This is already getting awkward. A little too old to be sitting on her dad's lap, who wants to relive the old days. Bring It On Home plays during. Then Jessie's father starts jerking off while she's sitting on his lap. She wakes up from this abuse nightmare. Jessie has horrid burning cramps in her arms. They need circulation. Thanks for being so supportive, inner Jessie. The inner couple bring us more into the abuse from her father. They say a lot of people base their romantic partners on their parents, so Gerald probably fits that dynamic. But do you see that big ass footprint? That's no hallucination, is it? The Moonlight Man might be back tonight. Jessie soon gets into another nightmare flashback. Right after her father masturbated to her, her father apologizes and says that they should tell Mom what happened. That's not what I expected the father to say. Mom will definitely blame her for it, since she's not a big fan of her, of the whole daughter-daddy relationship, I guess. Seems like he kinda manipulated her to come to the choice of not telling anybody. But either way, Jessie wakes up from this nightmare with the Moonlight Man licking her feet. Turns out in reality it was just a dog. It bites her feet, but she kicks it away, and it tears out another piece of that nice Gerald cut. The dog is gonna want fresher meat soon, so she better do something quickly before that dog smells weakness. The second day of captivity is almost over. Inner Gerald starts creeping her out again, scaring her by saying that she'll be a cold, stank corpse with a missing wedding ring and a bone stolen from her foot by the Moonlight Man. In another dream, Jessie has a quiet encounter with herself when she was young. Young Jessie tells her to remember. Don't remember the eclipse or the sun. Remember what happened after that. Well, after her father and her had that talk, dinner goes weird when Jessie crushes the glass in her hand. She is wounded, but that event gives her a painful way to get loose from the handcuffs now. It's gonna fucking hurt. That's literally what they say. Jessie and her inner self become a mirror at this point as they both agree that whatever Jessie is thinking, it could work. Jessie plans on cutting her wrist horizontally, using the blood to slip her hand out of the cuffs. She knows that the wrists have fewer nerves and it'll be slick. She knows a lot about cutting wrists. Okay, so fair warning, this next part is gonna be pretty harsh for the eyes. Ironically, this level of metal gore made me flinch more than anything in Rare a Dead Person. Now, once she starts, she has to finish it. Jessie grabs that glass and breaks it like years before, but sticks a shard into the wood. She then uses it to go slashing on her wrist. It hurts a lot, and she's not even feeling that much. She cuts through the skin and starts pulling her hand out of the cuff. The cuff starts literally degloving her, like pulling her skin off her hand, yanking and yanking until finally she gets it free. That actually disturbed me pretty good. That's the kind of stuff I remember years later. Finally free by one hand, she uses her foot to grab the phone, but it's dead. She carries the bed over to the counter and uses the key to get herself free. Clap it up for Jessie for making it out. Good work not dying. Right after wrapping her hand up, she falls from the pain and blood loss. She wakes up to the dog biting her, but she shows the dog who's boss. Gerald, he's been a dog treat for the past 2 days. Anyway, Jessie unlocks the car and it's almost out, but sees the dog freaked out. Turns out, it's the Moonlight Man. Jessie confronts him saying he's only made of moonlight, and gives him her wedding ring so he leaves her alone. I don't think he's really made of moonlight. Alive and free, Jessie drives off in the car saying one last goodbye to inner Gerald. She's been proving his ass wrong the whole night. Jessie is crashing hard though, but she has a mental escapade, Eclipse Edition. The Moonlight Man calls her Mouse in her car, but in reality, Jessie's passed out behind the wheel and crashes into a tree. Luckily, she's still alive, and some people in a nearby house rush to her help. Jessie is finally safe, but the Moonlight Man is following her home. Just a constant reminder that all she really did escape from that night was the cuffs. As months pass, Jessie starts writing a letter to her young self, thanking her for helping older her escape the shackles of silence, comfort, and misadventure. With the insurance money from Gerald's death, she starts a foundation for abused children like her and isn't silent about what happened to her anymore. Still, the Moonlight Man haunts her every night. That is until someone named Raymond Andrew Jorbert is arrested. Jorbert is a crypt creeper, someone who vandalizes graveyards and steals jewelry from corpses along with their eyes, noses, and ears. Not too long before he started having sex with male corpses too. And then he transitioned to the living. Jorbert suffers from acromegaly. So, you know, he has really large hands and arms, a forehead almost as big as Berlizzi, that kind of thing. The police found his sister and her husband scalped and cannibalized, along with a collection of body parts that would make Ed Gein proud. So in other words, the Moonlight Man that Jessie saw while trapped was an actual serial killer that has snuck into the lake house. It's just a big coincidence that a serial killer happened upon a woman trapped in handcuffs, but Jessie assumed he was fake, like almost every other thing she saw. Well, that Moonlight Man has been haunting her for 6 months, and she finally thinks it's time to confront the true, real person behind this all. She's not only confronting him, but she's confronting all of the pain. Her husband, her father. Jessie interrupts the trial of Jorbert, who turns around saying, "You're not real. You're only made of moonlight," mocking Jessie from 6 months ago. He literally breaks his confines. Despite the entire court shitting its pants, Jessie confronts all of the pain through him, her father, Gerald, and then the Moonlight Man. "You're so much smaller than I remember," she says. The movie ends as Jessie walks out of the court, sliding her sunglasses on, about to go make a few million dollars. No eclipse in sight. This is how "I Spit on Your Grave" should have ended. Jessie had that strength all along, and I'm very happy that she created the opportunities to help herself all throughout this movie. I want to be like her when I grow up. Now that we gotten through Gerald's game, let's talk about the most disturbing moment and most enjoyed moment in that spooky stuff. Cue the Gohan. I've been waiting to watch this movie. FoundFlix Sensei and Spooky Astronaut Sensei's videos just had me itching to watch. There are some differences from the book, but the movie is a nice adaption for sure. One of my best favorites to watch. The most disturbed moment is easily Jessie escaping by degloving her hand. Golly, you think watching death documentaries would make me flinch as much as this scene did. They did great with this scene, and I'm gonna remember it for years. Most enjoyed moment is without a doubt the ending, as Jessie walks in the middle of the fucking street and is scared of nothing. She's just walking towards the sunlight and is beaming right on her. Happy ending. Plus, you could play a whole mission complete sound effect over it, because in real life, missions, they take a long time to complete. And Jessie's mission? Fuck her father, fuck Gerald, and fuck the Moonlight Man. Let's make some money. And that's it. This Friday, I'll be uploading the next episodes for another, and the anime will be finished by next Monday. Also next Monday, I'll be uploading American Mary, the true second most voted film. Some other good films this reminds me of is films by Lars von Trier. So try out The House That Jack Built, a film about the inner workings of a serial killer. Also, check out Bedeviled, aka Bok-Nam Rises. Bok-Nam is one of my favorite characters ever. Thanks for watching. Spooky out!